Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cascade by Matthew Peed. Narrated by Gabriel Vaughan and Eva Kaminsky. Chapter 1. Regan. It had been 3 weeks since we'd dealt with the hordes. I'd made a lot less headway into the Deadlands than I would have liked. The severity of the mana corruption increased the farther the automata got from my base. I was in the middle of designing an emitter that would put out a bubble-like aura to cover a decent area, but the mana drain was quite high, so I was fine-tuning it to bring the drain down. As I stood on the ramparts of the wall overlooking the undead forest, Jarvis teleported next to me. His form had changed a bit from the amount of combat and mana usage. His head had changed to a more normal-looking human head, where instead of one large eye that took up most of his face, there were now two. His extended eyes, which would have reminded people of a beholder on Earth due to the tubes that connected them to his head, had changed into floating drones that circled him, each with access to different elements.
"Sir, we have reached 10 kilometers. The new antennae are working on cleaning and clearing the unholy mana from the forest, but there is resistance to the process," Jarvis said as he looked over the forest.
He put off a gentleman vibe the way he stood stick straight with his arms behind his back. "I know. Something is actively resisting me. I can sense the awareness behind it," I said with a frown. The presence had really made itself known after I'd extended my aura to the 5 kilometer mark. It was the first time I'd ever felt something push back, after all.
"What would you like to do?"
An explosion occurred a few kilometers into the forest, which was a common sound these days. A single person was able to slip through as Ren did, but for a force like mine to make headway into the north, we had to overcome tremendous resistance for every meter we took. All kinds of monsters blocked our way, but mostly ghouls and zombies. The research team had made some decent headway in researching the undead. The goblins got better at their work as they grew more accustomed to the technology in the labs. They even found a way to boost their immunity to the ambient mana from some of the information they gained from the ghouls. Apparently, being undead was a type of curse. The more I learned about these race-level magics and curses, the more worried I became about these higher-level beings and the Celestials. I needed to think up countermeasures before I encountered them, rather than after. From what I'd learned about mana, I knew they would have amounts I hadn't even seen before, so it would have been hard to outlast them like I had the necromancers. They would most likely have magics that would be on another level, given the fact that they were able to reach the 5th tier. From what I understood, that meant they understood their element enough to nearly fuse with it. Izal was a good example of what I would be dealing with if I had to fight a Celestial. From the few records I'd gotten from the people in town, one of the myths about reaching Tier 5 was that you became one with your element. I wasn't just twirling my thumbs. With the undead as the focus, I was making headway on several techniques that I felt would give anything a hard time. Most of it was still in testing, or required large amounts of mana to create. Just more things on the list that would need some tweaking before they became a viable means of offense or defense. I pulled myself from my thoughts, then turned to Jarvis. "I think it's time we launched it," I said with a smile. I'd been trying to find a good time to try out this experiment for a while. This felt like it to me.
"Understood, sir."
Jarvis bowed his head, and I teleported us over to the side of the fort nearest the mountains. A platform reminiscent to the rocket launch pads back on Earth lay there, with fumes from liquid nitrogen cooling the rocket that was prepared and ready to go. Sitting at the top of the rocket was another mithril-coated shelled core. I didn't know what to expect in a universe with monsters, so it wouldn't have surprised me if there'd been some sort of space tentacle monster out there. The mithril alloy coating would make sure it was protected. Once I established a geocentric orbit, Then I could worry more about defenses that might need to be prepared. It was far easier to build an escape velocity vehicle when I could build a seamless structure, as well as use magic for some of the systems. I was able to use some magic scripts to create barriers and cooling for the outer layer. With the way it was constructed, the vehicle would actually be able to leave the planet and return as long as it didn't run out of mana. Seeing the vessel made me recall Earth's attempts to get to space. Earth was close to having a space elevator, thanks to the work of a man named Elon from a few decades before my time. But, thanks to me, that had never come to fruition. Not much reason to go to space when high-energy positron lasers turned the vessel into scrap metal. I knew the stage launch of space vehicles from the satellites that my company sent into orbit. The problem was that I'd usually outsource that part of the equation to other companies back on Earth. I was basically working from scratch here. I was just throwing everything on it that I could think about with the hope that I covered all my bases. I basically wanted a fortress in space when I was done. We moved over to the command center near the launch pad.
"Sir, mana batteries are done charging," Jarvis reported as he examined the screens in front of him.
"Thank you. Begin countdown," I said with some excitement.
10, Jarvis began.
The rocket began to glow from the intermix of technology and magic working together to ready the vehicle for takeoff. 4 large rockets around the bottom started to release smoke. I was already pumping liquid nitrogen and water into the site, as I wasn't sure how much sound this thing would actually put off. Ice coated a good 10 meters around the launch site.
9.
Several automata and goblins sat around me in the command center at various stations, checking and double-checking the systems. They were on high alert, as I didn't want anything to go wrong. It might have been bad for their hearts, but they would only have to work at this high tension level for the first launch.
8. 7. 6.
The rocket started to shake as the engines were primed. I turned my eyes from the screens to the rocket outside the window. It had a sleek design, with a silverish coloring from the materials that went into it. Built as a large tower structure, I planned for it to be the heart of the new station when it reached space. Thanks to Louella, I'd gained quite a bit of materials that helped with higher-level technology. Just the experiments that my current workers were doing would take a few weeks to finish. If I could have focused on it myself, it might have sped the process up. But with the recent invasion, I had too many distractions to fully devote my attention to it.
5, 4, 3, 2.
The magic around the launch pad and the vehicle activated with a bright flash. Mana surged from all 3 cores, while the 4th, the steel spire core, only gave a trickle. All the runes activated as the engines flared.
1,
Jarvis yelled. I slammed my hand down on the big red button in the center of the console. The rockets fired with one of the most beautiful flames I'd ever seen. The water managed to suppress the sound considerably, but the roar could still be heard for kilometers. There was almost too much power as the launch pad and the surrounding ground cracked from the crater that formed. With a boom, the rocket shot into the sky. I connected to the cameras on the outside of the ship. My uplink to it was also in the green for now. As it left my aura a few kilometers in the air, the resistance I was feeling from the undead forest struck with force. Launching next to the mountains allowed me to use their aura to collide with the presence, which allowed the rocket to slip through the proverbial cracks during the clash. The rocket quickly gained speed and was soon going near Mach 40. The escape velocity of Earth was 28 kilometers per second, but this planet was much larger than Earth. Thus, I went ahead and boosted the velocity as much as I could. The cameras were shaking from the vibrations, but the rocket was holding steady as some of the scripts turned the kinetic energy into mana for the batteries. The rocket only continued to gain speed and quickly reached 35 kilometers per second and was still climbing. This would have been so much easier if I could have just teleported into space, but I was missing some type of variable for the magic to function properly. I'd tried it with a few devices in a few experiments, but they were all subsequently ripped apart by something as they crossed a sort of barrier around the planet. I was thinking that in the atmosphere there was another layer like the stratosphere, but made out of mana that prevented something like teleporting from the planet. Possibly an ancient celestial or god had placed it there to protect the mortals, but it was all assumptions. The rocket quickly gained altitude, and the wind drag was reduced as it passed the heavier layers. When one of the cameras hit something and was then covered in red for a few seconds, I guessed it had pulverized some type of monster bird that happened to get in its way. The heat on the outside of the ship reduced as it started to leave the atmosphere. Finally, the rocket reached low planetary orbit. As I'd suspected, it was nearly double that of Earth. The boosters died, and the rocket slowed as the gravity of the planet started to assert itself on the vessel. When it was at the 3,000-kilometer mark, I activated the ship's second phase. The metal started to shift and get rearranged. Two wings emerged, with multidirectional hydrogen thrusters at the end of each so that the ship could move in any direction. It shifted its direction so that it would be in high planetary orbit over the northern lands. I planned on starting the station there in case something happened when I activated the core. If for some reason it exploded, I wanted the debris to land on the enemy and not regular mortals. The vessel reached its destination, or at least that's where the spells and calculations I'd made put the craft. Back on the planet, I let my body fade into mana, as I wasn't sure what would happen. I mentally cracked my knuckles, then began to allow my aura to leave the core. The craft was almost stationary when compared to a satellite, but it was technically moving just a bit until it froze as if it had gotten stuck in concrete. Then I felt it start to move again, but it was locked into place over that spot on the planet. I felt a surge of mana as the aura expanded in the form of a bubble. I nearly got a head rush from the mana, as it felt completely different from what I absorb on the planet. Compared to any of the mana I'd absorbed before, this felt purer. I looked past the rush of mana to analyze the situation. I was absorbing all the emissions that would normally be bombarding the planet in this area. I made an active effort to allow sunlight through my aura, otherwise it would have been nearly pitch black under it. The space core quickly broke through to the second tier, and it hadn't even been 10 minutes. Thankfully, I was able to just barely push the core. Any more, and I could tell the core might fracture. I set up the core to take the mana and transfer it back to my main core. I could break through to tier 3 if possible. I wasn't sure if there was going to be a requirement once I gained that amount of mana. I left the original structure of the vehicle alone and started to expand the form into a proper station. I wasn't sure if people would be living there or not, but I did have the goblins that could potentially end up there one day. I went ahead and made it where they could live in the station without problem. Long term, there were a lot of magics I wanted to test up there. As I have certain abilities as a dungeon core, I was able to cheat a bit. I expanded from the original structure to create a central tower. Around halfway down, I expanded the surface out in a disc shape, much like the city I'd created in the north, and went ahead and created as many of the buildings as I considered necessary for my people to survive while living on it. Just to be safe, I covered all my bases by adding greenhouses and recycling systems for any inhabitants that I might move to the station in the future. While I was quite busy on this planet, apparently I could live a very long time and might consider taking a journey into space someday. I would have to figure out how to free my dungeon core for this permanent orbit going on, but like I said, plenty of time to work on that. To complete the station, I added a tower emitter every 45 degrees around the circle. It would emit a barrier that would serve as an atmosphere for the inhabitants. At its low setting, it could be maintained indefinitely by just absorbing the sunlight. But if it went into defensive mode, then it had a battery life of roughly 24 hours, depending on the attacks it was sustaining. As I was putting the finishing touches on the station, I felt someone call for me from my main dungeon. In the forests on the 10th floor, a pair stood with their entire bodies covered, except the man, who exposed his face, knowing I would be able to see it. I grinned conspiratorially as I went to see what they wanted.
Chapter 2. Louella.
Crime is at an all-time low, but morale is also down. That was the final line in a report sent over from Azal. The obelisks that Regan had created had indeed found quite a few necromancers, but we couldn't be sure that we'd gotten them all, for obvious reasons. Regular crime was down, as the report said, but without an outlet for the more dirty types of people. These people were just sitting around the town, usually at the bottom of a bottle of mead. We were trying to think up ways to get them up and moving, but it was hard to turn a thief to honest labor. The gnomes had basically set up their own foreign embassy, but Azura was reporting everything to me. Not that they could hide anything from Regan. Last I'd heard, he had claimed the entire valley in his aura. Though, thinking of Regan, I felt he'd been a bit distracted as of late. At least the town was still growing at a staggering rate. People were literally streaming into the valley from both countries. We implemented several laws to keep discrimination down, as more than one bar fight was between citizens of Lecazar and Thonaca going at it over stupid reasons. The last census that Azal had sent over placed the headcount at nearly 17,000 people. The town was about to reach a point where an inspector would come from the capital to make sure everything was in order and reclassify the town as needed. The construction and building guilds were working around the clock to fulfill everyone's requests. At least, they were always hiring for labor. The town had felt crowded to me before, but now it was even harder to make it around town. The biggest problem was that everywhere I needed to frequent due to my position, nearly everyone else had to go as well. The rural sections were nearly as bad as the market and central streets. I was glad the valley in which the town was in was able to house so many people and buildings. According to Thrad, the construction guild's master, we would be able to build a city that would rival the capitals. With Regan there, I wouldn't have been surprised if we surpassed them. He wasn't too big on the word limits. It was only a matter of time before the nobles tried to bully their way into the town. I'd already received several requests from manors and whatnot to be built for them. To each, I sent back a nice little note that basically said piss off in polite speak. I could be a little ruder to Lecazar nobles, but for the Thonican ones, I needed to word it a bit nicer. I wasn't in the mood to deal with the political issue. Looking around my office, I thought it might be one of the nicest rooms I'd ever been in. Regan had redone the townhouse like he said he would, but he went a different route from the giant tower in the forest. It was more of a castle now. There were two towers on each side that emitted a barrier that seemed to bend space. When people walked into the area of the castle, there was a lot more space than there appeared to be outside. I just wrote it off as Regan doing his dungeon thing.
"Little lady, there is a guest for you," Julie said as she walked into my office.
She'd at least started using lady when addressing me since the battle. In fact, quite a few people made sure to talk to me with care, though Rockris still didn't. I glanced at the small mirror on the wall. My beautiful black hair had turned a platinum blonde, the one change I wasn't too happy with. My clothes hid most of them, but lightning marks were tattooed over most of my body. The biggest change had to be my eyes, though. The pupils had turned into a miniature night sky. I motioned for Julie to allow the person in, and a large beastkin made his way in from behind her. He was a bearkin, who looked like he'd been on a rather long trip, as he was pretty rough for wear. I tried not to be rude by covering my nose, but it was hard to resist the temptation, given the smell he was giving off. What can I do for you? I asked.
I heard you were offering slave sanctuary, he said, as he moved to expose a part of his chest.
The purple ink the slavers used for the space crest popped out even on his sunburnt skin. Regan had told me about this a while ago. His forest town was letting slaves live there like normal people if they allowed him to subvert their slave crests. He'd given me a similar device in case they came here instead.
Indeed, I can offer you a type of freedom.
The dungeon here has made a device that binds the crest to him. With this, you can live as a normal mortal. And I have been assured that he doesn't have time to do anything with the slaves he binds, I explained.
As long as I can be free, I don't care, the man almost roared.
Very well, I said, then pulled the device out of my desk. I walked up to him. This will hurt a bit, I warned. I placed the rune-marked dagger against the center of his slave crest.
Hmm, he scoffed.
I smiled, as this wasn't the first time a slave had scoffed at the mention of pain. I tapped the end of the device to the center of his crest. A surge of mana entered it, and he roared as if he'd been stabbed by half a dozen swords. I hopped back quickly in case he went crazy. It had happened before, after all. He collapsed to the ground as he writhed in pain. I frowned as I noticed Julie seeming to enjoy it. I couldn't see her face to be sure. However, her body language said she was having the time of her life. The process usually took roughly a minute to complete, longer for a larger body like this guy. The process ended exactly 1 minute and 29 seconds later. I had to hand it to the man. Most started begging for it to end, one way or another, by that point. But other than the first roar, he didn't make a sound louder than groans of pain. After he lay on the floor for another minute or so, he sat up.
I guess freedom doesn't come pain-free, he said with a groan.
Indeed. Now, what's your name? I asked as he got to his feet.
Boris Lutt, ma'am,
Boris said with a bow. Well, Boris, now that you're free, want to join the town guard?
I'll consider it.
Fair enough, I said with a smile. For now, there is a bunkhouse set aside for freed slaves while they get back on their feet. It was a little hard to expect someone to be able to provide for themselves right after rebinding the crest. This allowed them to feel a little indebted to the valley for all we did for them. However, I didn't feel wronged if they decided to leave after they got more comfortable. They wanted to be free, after all.
Thank you for everything,
Boris said, then bowed as he backed out of the room. A guard saluted from the hallway, then escorted him from the building. After he left, I turned to Rockris and Julie. That's the 12th slave this week. The rate they are arriving is also increasing. It wasn't too bad to get the slaves in the valley. I just worried about the ones who had less than pleasant owners before. I didn't need a former slave attacking one of my citizens.
Master's other town has a whole operation set up to free slaves. They are being selective at the moment, so they don't free criminal slaves. But even with that, it might reach unprecedented levels compared with the history of the war on slavery,
Rockris explained. Then added,
the number of slaves in the forest has already hit triple digits.
I never thought I would be near the center of history-altering events like this, I said, as I rested my head on the desk. It was just one thing after another. We'd already suffered two attacks from necromancers. Hell, there were two in the room with me.
Only very few people are born knowing they will achieve greatness, and even fewer will know if they will fulfill that destiny. Just think about that marquee,
Julie said from her seat until I glared at her. Val would have been one of the strongest leaders on the continent if he had been allowed to flourish. Rockris glanced into the hallway, then commented.
Izal appears to be doing a good job training the new force.
I followed his gaze and saw the hallway lined with guards. There was a pair almost every 10 meters.
She even gained a new nickname. Izal the Fire Demon.
I wasn't sure if it had always been a problem, or if it was a recent development from her pregnancy, but she'd gained a wicked temper. Quite a few people had learned the hard way when she quite literally burned them. The new hospital that Regan had set up was getting a lot of visitors. That was another hot topic in town. This medical center had been a very big hit with the adventurers, as they didn't have to donate to a priest to get a healing. They only paid coppers on the silver for healings that would have been hard for a Laloon-sanctioned priest. The biggest thing was that the healings were consistent. If someone went in to heal a broken arm, then the arm was healed as stated. There were issues while using the priest's magic, which may heal an injury such as severe pain for several weeks. But later there might come swelling, or any number of bonus issues that people sometimes needed to deal with. Some of the light mages who were hesitating about joining the church had already joined Regan's healing center as students, but there was a long training session that they had to work hard at. While it was free to join, if you quit halfway through, there were fees. Last I'd heard, a woman wanted to be able to regenerate limbs, and an automaton head doctor, as they called themselves, had told her it would be nearly 6 years of learning to be able to do so. The only requirement for joining was to magically sign some type of oath about doing no harm. It was very adaptive, as it made a man who tried to learn secondhand sign it before he could actually hear what the other man was trying to teach him. The hospital took care of any light mages who signed the oath with a division of automata that were assigned to guard the men and women. They used light mana and were quite powerful, from the reports I got from Izal. They were led by two automata that called themselves Apollo and Aurora. Before the obelisks were installed all through town, one of the students made their way into the sea of tents outside the town to try to help anyone who might have gotten hurt in the dungeon. He was jumped for his coin, but Apollo happened to be with him. It managed to incapacitate all the attackers with a single weapon that fired some type of canister that exploded out with pure light. The men were unable to see for several days before they crawled to the man and begged him to help them. It was becoming so normal for the valley to be in a state of change that I was actually dealing with all this relatively well, in my opinion. Izal was doing a good job with security. Cassie was keeping the adventurers in line. The guilds were all happy about the continued increase to their membership in the valley. Personally, I was pleased about the valley doing so well, considering that it was where I'd come to basically run away from my family. I pulled myself from my thoughts and looked down at my desk. The downside to having a large desk was that it was able to fit more paperwork. I decided I needed a break and stood up to go on a walk. Regan had made this place nearly impenetrable, according to my understanding, so I had no worries while in the castle. Not that I was too worried about being attacked again. My comprehension of lightning had reached a new scale, thanks to me quite literally fusing myself to it. While my memory of that event was spotty, I would probably break through to Tier 3 without much difficulty, as long as the universe didn't throw a curveball.
Chapter 3. Regan. The hooded pair looked me over as I appeared in front of them. I, of course, wasn't taking any chances and had appeared a few meters away. I'd learned the hard way that few people can be trusted in this world, even if you thought you knew them. Magic was capable of great good, but more often than not, it was used for evil by people with too much ambition for their own good. "I have to say I'm pleasantly surprised to see you," I said to the person who was supposed to be dead. While I didn't personally care, I knew someone in the valley that would have been quite happy to see him. Plus, I liked seeing people reunited. "As I am you, I need to ask that you not use my name," Valimar said with a grimace. I nodded in agreement. "Fair enough. Never know who might be listening. What can I do for you?" I asked. "I need an edge against our common enemy," Valimar growled. I could almost feel the anger radiating off him. "Ah, a little revenge is always a good motivator," I said with a knowing nod. But are you sure? Taking this path might lead you down a road that will be hard to return from. I wanted to know he was certain, from what I'd found through various experiments, such as with Azra. Once I changed a person, it was very permanent, at least to the magic I had access to as a dungeon, which was considerable. I am well aware of that from my journey here. If there is to be a future for me and mine, then I have to do this. Very well. Do you want low or high? Note that if I use the high, I will be binding you to me, I warned. I need as much power as I can get. Do what you have to do, he declared with force, then deflated a bit as he turned to his partner. No matter what happens, thank you for all your help during this trying time. You're free to do as you please.
Thank you, my lord, but I have as much a reason to stay as you,
the woman said with a slight bow, then turned to me.
This may be out of line, but I would like to request the high level as well.
Loyal servants as always, I see, I said with a sly grin. I probably wouldn't be here if it wasn't for her. She did save my life, after all. I laughed. Men are supposed to protect the women, isn't that right, I started to say, before I remembered he didn't want me to use his name. The man frowned, then sighed. How is she? Well enough, I would wager. Your friend Bruce has been keeping watch over her. Quite disturbing, actually, the way he tries to do everything for her. If you didn't know the man, you would think he was in love with her. He is loyal to a fault, but I trust him to protect her. When I finish my quest, I will repay him with whatever he wants, as long as I am capable of delivering it, the man said with one of the most serious faces I thought I'd ever seen in either of my lives. But enough of him. I would like to hear how you survived, I said, unable to control my curiosity. As for my survival, I have Urena to thank for that, he said as he glanced over to the woman. Oh, I do love a good mystery, but the suspense is killing me. He sighed, then explained how Urena had been thrown under the building when it was bombarded with the spells. She'd survived more due to her dwarven stature than any martial skill, and quickly realized what was going on. As the dragon had attacked, she'd pulled clear the body of a servant who was roughly the same size as him. When Neldor gave his life for them in a truly heroic moment, they made the switch with Valimar, casting an illusion over Valimar's face, which kept it simple enough to be unnoticed with the large amount of mana in the area. She then buried them almost 50 meters underground for nearly a week to be sure there weren't any watchers. And I could bore you with the happenings as we made our way here, but I have necromancers to kill, Valimar growled. All right then, let's have ourselves some fun, I said with a little more excitement than I meant to. I leave myself in your hands, Valimar said as he bowed, switching to a calm state unnaturally fast. Urena bowed as well. I moved them to the north, where there was more free space to work with. Then I teleported us to an open lot to one side of the fort. Hundreds of automata were working on one project or another. Just as we appeared, one team of automata was hauling a hulking creature that reminded me of a giant but with rotted patches all over it. I would have to look at the reports from that later. Valimar looked around in awe. He'd probably never seen a place with such a uniform and smooth structure before. I pointed to the middle of the lot and told him to stand there as I tried to decide how best to go through with this. I already had a general idea, but wanted to be sure it fit with his style. Unlike my automata, he wouldn't be able to learn how to use a weapon that he'd never touched before. As I thought through my options, I decided to let magic decide. There was a simple but effective method to increase his power that I hadn't used in a while. It would also bind him to the dungeon so I could keep tabs on him. I planned to give him a collar, but extra protection never hurt. I channeled the bind creature spell I'd acquired so long ago. In fact, the last time I'd used it had been on Azra, a giant complex spell structure formed around Valimar with a diameter of 10 meters. Thousands of runes and scripts were woven together to create a spell that was more complicated by 100 times than the one I'd used on Azra. Something interesting happened at that point, as mana didn't just flow from my main core, but from my 3 subcores as well. The Spire core seemed to be far and didn't provide any more mana than a trickle. I'd noted this occurrence while working on the station. Distance really did play a factor on certain functions of my cores. Valimar screamed as more mana than a human should have been capable of handling collided with him. I wasn't positive of my analogy, but it probably felt like a million needles trying to force their way in through every spot of his body. I quickly gained control of the flow of mana and slowed it to a more manageable level. I allowed it to keep flowing until the spell stopped on its own. With roughly 2 million mana coursing through his body, Valimar literally glowed at the moment. He collapsed to his knees from the pain, breathing heavily. Cracks formed over his body as the mana transformed him. Slowly, Valimar stood up with a surge of power, and his body exploded suddenly, then condensed. A much more powerful version stood where he'd been a moment ago. 3 halos floated behind his back in the form of large gears, probably an influence from my mana. 2 blades, one that seemed to be formed from a sun, the other from the blackness of space, rested in his hands. It reminded me of Asura from Hinduism. It also looked like I had pushed him over into tier 3 in the process. I could feel my underlying control over him, however, so I wasn't worried. I'd learned a lot since the time with Azra and all the continuous creations that I'd been doing. Just to be safe, I materialized a collar around his neck and wrists before he came completely back to himself. It was easier to affect his personage when he was part of the dungeon. Valimar roared loudly enough to shake the surrounding forest as he surged to his feet. The ground cracked under him as he flexed his new level of mana. Something farther in the forest roared back, but I ignored that for now. Steam was released from Valimar as he calmed down from the mana high. I looked closer and saw that his skin was metal now, though it still looked like regular skin. Internally, he had completely changed. He was almost a living machine, as most of his body had changed, but the parts that made him mortal had only been upgraded and optimized. I guessed you could call him a cyborg now. Panting, he looked over to me, then said, "You're one scary being, Sir Regan." "Aw, stop that. You're making me blush," I said as I laughed. "Don't tell her about me, please," he pleaded, his eyes sincere. I debated telling him that she had already gotten some upgrades herself, but left it alone and just nodded. They could sort that out for themselves later. As they say, love can cross all boundaries. He stared at me for another moment before he fell over backward. His eyes rolled back and he breathed heavily, but I knew that he was quite well. His soul was still adapting to the massive change in shell and amount of energy. In Luella's case, she'd been able to expel most of the energy. With this, however, he was forced to endure the molten fire that was locked in his veins. I looked down at Urena next to me. "Still want to go?" I asked with an evil grin.
"Yes, Sir Regan," she said without hesitation.
In a sense, I felt she was almost braver than Valimar. It took a lot of guts to witness something like that and still want to go through with it, especially since she was essentially giving up her freedom. "Well, damn, I was hoping for a slight shudder or something," I said, a bit disappointed. I moved Valimar's body out of the way, and the woman walked onto the stage. The spell began the same way, as I didn't plan on holding back with these two. I would basically be able to control them if something were to happen. As I'd mentioned before to Louella, pawns were useful. I was more prepared this time as I grabbed the tremendous rush of mana that surged toward her. I let it flow a bit slower, but too slow would affect the transformation as well as be painful longer. Soon, another cyborg stood in front of me. There wasn't as much change as with Valimar, as I believe she had been a rogue and was keeping true to her roots. I could see that quite a few of her systems were set for infiltration. I collared her when she collapsed from the intense power that was rushing through her veins. Looking each of them over, I felt sorry for whoever got in their way. As I teleported them to an out-of-the-way section of the West Forest, I made sure to copy their designs. With a few alterations, I could make fully functional automata to fill my ranks. I left them a map marking where they were, then let my body dissipate. They would be more than able to handle anything that came their way, and the area was empty due to the recent horde battle. The ecosystem was still repairing itself. Now that the distraction was over, I moved back to my space station. Just thinking that phrase made me a bit giddy. I wanted to be able to see the entire north, so I needed to build a network of satellites. I went to an assembly area that I designed so that the station could build anything from spare parts to ships. As long as this area was undamaged, it would be able to repair the entire station, provided that they were able to get power and materials to it. I designed an advanced satellite that only used one magic script, which was to draw in mana from sunlight and convert it to electricity. The rest was created using good old technology, or magitech, technically. While it didn't operate on pure mana, it still used magic to function. It was all hardware-based, hence only one script was needed. I felt that this way it would last longer. The satellite was a cube, each side roughly 2 meters. An array of cameras and sensors lined the surface of each side. Compressed ion thrusters were able to keep it moving without any troubles for the task I had in mind. I launched it out into the upper atmosphere. This one was set to watch the area right below the station. I could have put the camera on the station, but I felt a good network should be uniform. It moved below, then activated its communications array. I used a quantum link so the network should never have any lag, while not requiring as much hardware to function, an easy feat with magic. With the uplink established, I set it to start mapping the area directly below the station. The first images came up on the center console, while a large holographic image appeared over a sizable table located in the command center. It's nice being a dungeon core, as I can spread my consciousness over a large area. Down on the surface, a hellscape appeared. The still compiling image seemed to make it worse. A very dead-looking forest surrounded a castle made of pitch-black stone and what looked like milk-white bones. I felt it was a little cliché, but they wouldn't know that. A fog covered an area of roughly 100 kilometers, which was most of the initial coverage my satellite managed. The satellite finished another scan, and the image cleared up considerably. Undead as far as the eye could see. It looked like every mortal who had been in the north was changed. I couldn't read their mana levels from the satellite, but there were several hundred that must have been over Tier 3. I tapped my chin as I looked over the image, coming up with a few ideas that would remove most of the surface issues, but the 94 floors were going to be the real issue. Unlike me, Alara had most likely built her dungeon to keep everyone out at the command of her masters. Every step down would have been a battle. At least I had Anubis. I could replicate his design into a troop of soldiers who would be able to fight their way down as a nearly perfect enemy against the necromancers. For now, I just needed to get my forces there. A space drop was ideal, but just to the outskirts of the north, since some type of presence was already interfering. Until I found the source of that, I would hold off on space insertion. I plotted out the network that I wanted the station to set up so that it would automatically produce the satellites. Even if I was moving my forces over ground, I needed to have a decent map. There were at least 1,000 kilometers between Alara and me, not to mention the fact that the rest of the continent also needed to be mapped accurately. With that in mind, I created a larger probe and sent it out to start sweeping the planet. When it reached 50 kilometers, there was suddenly a discharge of energy. The mana that was being absorbed by the cube surged, and the satellite exploded. I tried again, but only got the same result. I mentally rubbed my chin as I examined the problem while pausing the assembly line. I created a third probe and set it with a feedback link to the core. Launching the probe, I waited to see what would happen. When it reached the 50-kilometer mark, its mana surged again, but it flowed back to my core, giving me nearly 10,000 mana all at once. It quickly reached the 70-kilometer mark. The mana surged again, this time too much for my link. This reinforced my theory that a race had done something to protect the planet. For now, I created a new version of the satellite that possessed a mana stone the size of a small car. It increased the cost and size of the satellite by a considerable amount, but was required. From there, I set the network to transfer the energy among the satellites. That would keep the surges under control until I learned more about the cause. For now, the networks showed that the cause was a certain distance from my aura, and the surges happened every hour or so. I welcomed the mana, but knew it would put stress on the devices. However, there was little I could do about it at that point. I moved over to another section of the assembly and set it to create some worker automata for the station. They were multi-purpose robots that could operate a workstation or sweep the floor, basically drones for all intents. The station was feeling empty, though. I did a few more chores on the station before I decided to take a break. It grew quiet as I reduced all the information I was getting from all various sources around the dungeon. Ignea, Jarvis, Saga, and all my children had been told to let me know if something happened, and even if something did, not much could get to my core that fast without me being violently aware of it. Sensing through the multiple links I could form, I connected with the one I'd begun visiting at least once a week recently. The world faded, then the two-sided room formed as it had the first time. I looked forward to the day I could see her in person. As the black throne with the hundreds of black chains bearing blood-red runes formed in front of me, I couldn't help but smile sadly as the figure being restrained by them came into view. I'd done a lot of self-analysis since the second time I'd seen her. Not understanding why I was drawn to her, wanted to rescue her. While she was beautiful, as a man from Earth with access to the internet, I'd seen plenty of women in my time. The only guess I had was due to how similar her situation was to my own on Earth. She was being forced to serve the necromancers against her will. Whether I felt love, as a scientist, I wasn't quite sure. As a man, I had to say probably. As a dungeon core, who the hell knows? Ignea had informed me that dungeon cores could create offspring between two cores, but it came at the cost of half of each parent's current cultivation, a steep price to pay for most any being on this planet. I wondered to myself how that would affect me, considering I had multiple cores, but that was for the future. The very far future, hopefully. Alara slowly opened her eyes, then looked at me. She could barely move any part of her body, but her eyes were able to speak volumes. Having these one-sided conversations with her, I was getting better at the subtle cues that she gave. At least I hoped I was. "Afternoon, Alara. It's that time of the week," I said with a smile. Her mouth twitched as her eyes danced. "Ha ha, it's good to see you too." She squinted at me, then looked at the ground. "No, a few more weeks, I'm afraid. I can't afford to take the necromancers lightly. They would take it out on you," I said as I shook my head. Her eyes got visibly sad, then they hardened. "I know you'll wait for me. As I said before, I promise to let you see the sun on your own terms again." The link lasted for about 30 minutes to an hour if I forced it, so I spent that entire time with Alara. A one-sided conversation doesn't last very long, so I started telling her stories from Earth, like Little Red Riding Hood, all the various Disney princess tales, especially the alien princess one. That one had been one of Disney's bestsellers. Basically, I just kept her company.
Chapter 4. Azora.
Captain Mesu, for the last time, no, you cannot execute the traitors. I shouted at the captain of the Gwendianer. When his ship had entered the dock, the tall obelisk at the top, put there by Regan, had activated, and several members of his crew had fallen unconscious. They panicked at first, until they were told what that meant.
They are traitors. They don't even have any valuable information, except our own, that could be of use. They are basically dead weight, Captain Mesu argued. Worse, dead weight that is willing to bring us down with them.
I understand that, I said weakly. I knew they should be hanged for their crimes. To gnomes, treason was quite high on the list of capital offenses, but I was saddened by the fact that 12 of the crew were corrupted by the necromancers. They were thoroughly checked, and no trace of slave marks or collars were found. The healers even checked their internals over to be sure that they hadn't been placed inside, but found nothing.
Princess, I know they are gnomes and thus your people, but any one of them is a potential leak of information. With the current state of the world, I would say that national security is more important.
I agree. Just let me think on it one more day, please, I said, defeated.
Fine, but I will be reporting this to the king, Captain Mesu said with anger clear in his tone.
I couldn't even find it in me to get annoyed at him. I slinked back to my cabin to have some privacy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.